Hello and welcome to the today's lecture, which also happens to be the last lecture on reflector antenna. So we'll quickly start with where we had left in the last lecture. So in the last lecture we looked at the parabolic reflector antenna and we saw that OP plus PQ is equal to constant, and from there we had derived a relationship for F by D which is related to theta 0. Then we started talking about spillover efficiency as well as taper efficiency. So let us start from that particular slide one more time just to refresh the memory. So here we have the two same reflectors, but in this particular case feed has a larger, you can say uniformity here. You can see that the half power beam width here is relatively larger, over here half power beam width is relatively small. And in this case we had seen that spillover efficiency is relatively good, that means there is a low spillover efficiency. But in this particular case we had seen that there is a low spillover, that means high spillover efficiency, but the taper efficiency was relatively low. And in this particular case we had seen that the taper efficiency is high but spillover efficiency is low because there is a higher spillover. And we also looked at the plot of these two things here. So we can see that as the reflector angle increases, so if the reflector angle increases for the same beam pattern, you can see that spillover efficiency will be very high, because if angle is increased significantly, there will be very little spillover and hence spillover efficiency will be high. And if the theta 0 is very small, that means if the reflector itself is very small, that means it is not going to receive much, and in that case spillover efficiency will be very poor or spillover will be very high. And taper efficiency is reverse of that, and the product of these two, which is sometimes also defined as aperture efficiency, we saw that also. And we saw that the aperture efficiency is product of the two, which starts from a 0, and somewhere in this particular region we can see that efficiency is kind of maximum, and you can see some small correlation also. So this is the half power beam width of the feed horn, and if you look at the line down below here, so the reflector aperture angle is also of the same order. If you look at this here, this is if it is around 35 degree, you can see that this one here also corresponds for that particular angle, or if the half power beam width is large, then theta 0 also should be large, and that is where you get a relatively maximum aperture efficiency. But now the question comes that these are the aperture efficiency, but we had discussed about many other things. So I just want to tell one more time, even though it is mentioned as aperture efficiency, but this is really product of only two efficiencies, which are spillover efficiency and taper efficiency. So now let's just see what are the other four efficiencies and where do they come from and what are their role. So now this is the next one here, is a phase efficiency. Now where is the phase efficiency coming into picture? So for that to understand, you have to actually go back and look into this figure again here. Now what we assume that this particular thing, we have designed it. So when you design it, we think about a perfect parabola, right? But when we do the fabrication, now there is a possibility that this particular thing may never be exactly the same. Now just imagine if suppose if this is a, let's say a 2 meter dish antenna. Now if it is a 2 meter, that means diameter is 2 meter. Now what is the guarantee that this particular thing will follow exactly the same pattern? There is a possibility that this point may be at this place here, or it may be this place, and the error may be relatively small in the alignment. So over, let's say the diameter of 2 meter, the possibility of having an error of let's say 1 or 2 centimeter is always there. And now what really happens, suppose instead of this, let's say this particular thing is deformed or manufacturing error is there, so it is somewhere here. So if it is somewhere here, that means now this length will now be up to this point, it will reflect here and then come back. That means now this distance traveled is more compared to the distance traveled where there is a no error. And this larger distance traveled gives rise to the phase error. Now I want you to recall horn antenna discussion when we were talking about the horn antenna. What we had seen that the horn antenna, the phase error increases if this whole thing increases, right? Why? Because at this point, which is the reference point, and at this angle, we will see that there is an additional phase error. And there also we had mentioned about that if the phase error is about 90 degree, which is what many of the conventional books say, that 90 degree phase error is allowed. But I had mentioned that a 90 degree phase error gives rise to the poor efficiency. In fact, that itself gives efficiency of the order of 50 to 60%. And if you want an efficiency of 70% or more, then the phase error has to be maybe 45 degree or so. And here, let's see what is that 90 degree. That is, if we go for the maximum one, and 90 degree gives rise to almost efficiency of 0.5 or 0.6. So 90 degree would actually mean additional length of lambda by 4. And now what we talked about, this was the ideal one, and because of the manufacturing defect, it became like this. So that means the distance traveled will be more. And now suppose if it the error, as I said, even if the error is say about 1 centimeter, so it goes there and reflects back, let's say it reflected back, distance traveled extra is 1 centimeter. You're talking about a 2 meter diameter, 1 centimeter actually is possible. It does happen many a times if you don't do proper fabrication. So in that case, what happens now? Let's see if we are working at what frequency. Suppose we are working at, let's say, 3 gigahertz. At 3 gigahertz, wavelength will be 10 centimeter. Lambda by 4 will be 2.5 centimeter. So this 1 centimeter error will not give rise to too much phase error. So it is okay. But now think about if we are working at 30 gigahertz. So at 30 gigahertz, wavelength is 1 centimeter. And if you are talking about 1 centimeter additional thing, that means a phase error of 360 degree. And that is definitely not allowed. So that means at 3 gigahertz, that phase deviation whatever was there, that may be allowed, but at higher frequency the dimension tolerances required are very, very strict, and we cannot allow a distance extra of 1 centimeter. In fact, for a 30 gigahertz system, even a 0.25 centimeter will give rise to a 90 degree phase difference, and that will make efficiency straightway from 1 to 0.5. And this 0.5 will get multiplied to the rest of the term. So the phase error comes mainly because of this particular term here. So now let's just see what is the next efficiency. The next efficiency is polarization efficiency. This polarization efficiency really depends upon the feed. So suppose if we have a, let's say, linearly polarized thing, so we need to see what is the linearly polarized component in one plane and in the other plane. So if you can design a good linearly polarized antenna, or if it is a circularly polarized, we need to actually see that it should have a good LHCP and not a good RHCP. Okay, so the separation between LHCP and RHCP should be minimum 20 dB in the operating beam width. Then let's see what are the next efficiency. The next efficiency is blockage efficiency. So let's see what that comes from. So blockage efficiency come from, let's say now this feed which is radiating, the beam goes over here and reflects back. So this particular portion of the feed will block the radiation going in the far away distance. So basically, and this area is the where we have the maximum radiation which is coming back over here and which is getting blocked, and since it is getting blocked, that means efficiency will get poor. So it is always an advisable thing that try to design an antenna, feed antenna, which has a relatively smaller aperture here, then it will have a relatively less blockage, and in that case we can have very good efficiency. So in fact, to reduce the blockage, many a times people don't use prime focus feed, but they actually use a offset feed. So instead of putting the feed over here, feed is actually put over here, and this has to be designed in a different way so that when the feed is put over here, it goes like this and all the rays come out in parallel, and the blockage in that case will be close to zero. So over here, blockage will really depend upon the block by the horn antenna or microstrip antenna or helical antenna or whatever antenna we have used over here. Now we have to also look at the blockage can be approximately calculated. Very approximately is what is the area of this particular portion, and then you see what is the area of this particular feed here. Take the ratio of this with that, and that will actually tell us what is the typical blockage coming out of that. So generally speaking, the blockage efficiency can be 0.9 to 0.98 depending upon the size of the feed. Then comes the last one, which is known as a random error efficiency, which is epsilon r. Where is that coming from? The random error efficiency comes from the fact that, let's say again, it comes from the manufacturing fact. So we want a perfect parabola, and that what it really means that it should have a mirror finish. And when we use the term mirror finish means that it's absolutely a smooth surface. But in reality, when we are doing some engineering over here, the surface may not be smooth. It may be something like zigzag, zigzag, something like that over here. And now that zigzag may be of the order of fraction of millimeter, but that fraction of millimeter itself, what it creates. So if you think about this zigzag, will have a little angles like this. So the wave which is coming here will actually see a different angle, and then it may try to disperse from here to there. And also that different direction may give rise to a small phase error also. You may say that phase error was accounted in epsilon p. No, that phase error was because of the deviation over here. This we are talking about random, which is the randomness of this. So basically that can be taken care of. So after the machining, what people do, they use actually kind of smoothing surface of this technique. So sometimes they do some electroplating on this particular surface so that it becomes smooth, or sometimes they do some sand blasting or so that it can be made surface as a smooth surface. So the ideal surface, which is known as a glass finish, okay, but reality can be different. So this again, surface randomness error is more prominent at the higher frequency than at the lower frequency. So let's see what are the other things. So these are the efficiencies, and when we are designing a reflector antenna, design basically considers these two things. Most of the time these are more related to the fabrication error, and this of course is related to again the design issues here, but the fabrication tolerances are directly governing the value of especially epsilon p and epsilon r. So if we take care of these things, one can design a good reflector antenna. So now let's just move on to the next reflector antenna, which is actually speaking known as a Cassegrain reflector antenna. This is slightly different. You can actually see that there are two reflectors are there. There's a one, this is known as a main reflector, and this one is known as a secondary reflector, okay. And here what we have, the feed is put over here, and then this feed radiates. So you can see that this radiates here, it reflects back from this surface, goes over here and then goes like this. Then this one here goes here, reflects back and then goes in this particular direction. Now you can actually see that blockage in this particular case is much larger compared to the previous case. If we had put the prime focus feed here, you can see that if this was over here, blockage would have been less. Then why do we use this? Most of the time Cassegrain reflector antennas are used especially for high power transmission case, where we may have a large generator over here which could be a high power source, can be magnetron, klystron, gigatron and so on, and they also require large power supply. So generally that is put behind this particular reflector, and the output of that is directly connected to this particular antenna. So basically if we had put this particular thing over here, then the blockage would have been even more. Now, alternatively, one can think that why not we put this entire thing, use a waveguide feed and then connect over here. The problem with that is that since we are transmitting a very high power, and even a waveguide will have some losses from this point over here, and those losses also will be relatively more, and also for high power, a heating of waveguide can also take place, which may require some cooling. All of that thing can be taken care in this particular fashion here. Now, beside this Cassegrain reflector antenna, there are many other configurations are also possible. I did mention about offset reflector antenna. In fact, many a times you might have seen, for example, all these dish TV antenna which receive the signal, and these days they typically work on the frequency band of 11 gigahertz roundabout. So when they are receiving that signal, and if you see that particular thing, a dish actually has an offset feed, and this is, let's say, pointed towards the satellite, and this is the offset feed. The things which are reflected back, signal coming from the satellite reflects back, focus at this offset feed. That is the one of the thing. Then the another one which is actually very popular, that is known as a cylindrical parabola reflector. In fact, the cylindrical parabola reflector shape is something like this here, okay. So it has a part of the cylindrical shape, but this is a parabola. So this kind of a thing is actually used at the airports. If you have gone there, you might see that there is a big structure is there, which is continuously rotating all around. So basically what it is doing, it is looking at the incoming planes. So what it is really doing here, let's say this one here, this aperture is relatively small, so beam width will be large in this plane, and since this one here is a large, beam will be narrow in this one. So think about this particular thing case here, so narrow beam in this one and a broad beam. So that means now any plane which is coming or taking off will be covered here, and now it is looking at only a smaller angle, and now this is rotating and the signal is coming here. So whenever it is sending the signal, reflected back signal will come, so it will know that for this particular position we get the signal. So that means there is a plane in this, then it is rotating, so if you get a signal from this side, so we know that what is the approximate distance of the plane. Of course, in more complicated configurations where they want to know even this particular height here, so there they use multiple arrays of antennas. So what they do it is that each of these one will receive signal from the transmit and receive, and then you process it. In that case, you will know at what angle the plane could be, okay. And most of the time those are used more by the defense people. This one is of course commercial application. They are also known as a spherical reflector antenna. So spherical reflector antenna are nothing but just part of a sphere, but only a portion of that is used. And the property of the sphere is that anything which is put at the center, it goes here, reflects back in this direction. Then if you put some feed here, it transmits in this side and reflects back. So generally speaking, at a given time, it only illuminates a smaller portion of the spherical reflector antenna. So you can actually say that it uses multiple feed. So one feed is put in this, reflects, so beam maxima is going in this direction. Another feed which is in this particular direction, it goes there, radiates, reflects back. So generally a spherical reflector is not used for its property of a very high gain, but it is actually use one reflector with multiple feed so that you can look at different beam angles. So now let's just look at what are the different types of large reflector antennas available in the world. So let's see what we have here. This is the gain in dB. You can see here this is 60 dB, 70 dB and 80 dB. 60 dB, as I mentioned earlier, is 1 million. So gain is very, very high. What we see here is a wavelength which is varying from 0.1 to 30. So 30 centimeter wavelength corresponds to 1 gigahertz, and this one here, 1 centimeter corresponds to 30 gigahertz. So let's just see here, these are the two antennas which are actually in Arcebolo, which is in Puerto Rico area, and see the size. This is the 215 meter diameter and that's a 305 diameter. That's really huge, humongous antenna. And generally these antennas are working at the lower frequency range. You can see this is 1 gigahertz, this is 3 gigahertz. Then you can see that this is relatively smaller, but not very small. This is still like 100. And you can see what is the gain. At here, this is a 60 giga dB gain. It is going all the most close to 80 dB gain here. And you can see these are the different things here. Now you can see one interesting thing, that all these things are increasing linearly, which should actually happen if we are reducing the wavelength, that means increasing the frequency. But you can actually see that at this particular point, you can see that the gain has started reducing. So even though wavelength is reduced, and if the wavelength is reduced, directivity should have increased or gain should have increased, but it is not increasing, it has started decreasing. And these are the typical problems which are arising due to the phase error problem as well as random error problem. So those are the main things which reduces. So these are the typically very large reflector antenna, and I can tell you that this kind of a gain is only possible with the reflector antenna and not possible with the any other type of antennas. Now I would like to conclude the entire course. So in this particular course, we started with the simple fundamentals of antennas. So we talked about VSWR, we talked about input impedance, we talked about reflection coefficient, and then we talked about the radiation pattern, we talked about the crosspolar, we talked about first null beam width, and then we talked about the gain relation with the aperture. So these were the basic thing. We talked about Frisch transmission equation, which is very, very powerful equation to do a link design or link budget. And after that, we talked about the very basic antenna, which is known as a dipole antenna. And we saw that the radiation pattern of the dipole antenna varies if you keep on increasing its length. And of course, most popular one is a lambda by 2 dipole antenna because it is a resonant structure. We saw what is the input impedance. We also looked at the design, how to design a dipole antenna for a real input impedance. And if you recall, the formula we had seen was L plus D equal to 0.48 lambda. And if you use that, you can design a dipole antenna. And we also saw that the bandwidth is proportional to the diameter of the dipole antenna. Or alternatively, we can use conical dipole antenna. And then we talked about a monopole antenna. First, we discussed about monopole antenna on infinite ground plane. And we know that there is nothing like an infinite ground plane. And then we talked about monopole antenna on finite ground plane. And there we saw that the finite ground plane plays very, very important role. And the size of the ground plane, really speaking, controls the input impedance of the monopole antenna and also the gain of the monopole antenna and radiation pattern. Then we talked about slot antenna and loop antenna. Slot antenna is nothing but the complement of the dipole antenna, and the loop antenna can be thought of as a magnetic dipole antenna. And we had also mentioned that majority of the time we use loop antenna which are smaller in size, and we generally don't use large loop antenna. After that, we talked about linear and planar arrays. So in the linear arrays, we initially talked about uniform amplitude distribution, and then we saw different characteristics. So we saw how to calculate the radiation pattern, how to calculate side lobe levels, how to calculate first null beam width, and so on and so forth. And then from there, we went to talked about uniform distribution to non-uniform distribution. So we saw that there is a triangular distribution, cosine square distribution, and basically by using these distribution, we could actually improve the side lobe level. And of course, side lobe levels reduced, but gain reduced slightly. After that, we talked about planar array, and we saw that how we can control the beam width in both the plane, E plane as well as H plane. After that, we talked in length about microstrip antenna. The reason for that is microstrip antennas are becoming very, very popular. They are replacing many conventional antennas, and that is why there has been a lot of focus on microstrip antenna. So we talked about several different things in the microstrip antenna. We started with the basic configuration like rectangular, circular, triangular shape. Then we talked about broadband microstrip antenna, and whereby adding parasitic elements in the planar dimension or in the vertical dimension or both planar and vertical, we could increase the bandwidth from typically 2 to 5% to all the way to 20%, 30% or even more. Then we also talked about circularly polarized microstrip antenna. We talked about compact microstrip antenna. We talked about multi-band microstrip antenna. And after that, we concluded microstrip antenna with various microstrip antenna array configuration. After that, we talked about helical antenna, and we looked at two different modes of helical antenna, normal mode and axial mode. And generally speaking, normal mode is a nice replacement of a monopole antenna, and the axial mode helical antennas are generally used for circularly polarized antenna configurations. And then we talked about horn antenna, and we emphasize that the phase error of 90 degree and 135 degree is not acceptable. And in general, you should design for a phase error of maybe 45 degree and not more than that. And after the horn antenna, we talked about Yagi-Uda and log periodic antenna. And we saw that Yagi-Uda antennas are generally used for high gain application, and log periodic antennas are generally used for broadband application. And nowadays, lot of research is going on where people are combining the benefits of Yagi-Uda and log periodic antenna. So that's a very good research topic. You can look into that also. And then we concluded the whole thing by covering reflector antenna. So where we talked about the plane reflector antenna, we talked about corner reflector antenna, and we talked about the parabolic reflector antenna. Now, I also want to tell you that there are many other types of antennas are also there. For example, there's a lens antennas are there. There are spiral antennas are there and many other things. But in this particular course, it was not possible to cover each and everything. I actually felt that it is better that we understand few antennas in depth, and then once you have understood some of the antennas properly, you can apply the same concept to understand other types of antennas. So from my side, I tried to give you also the practical part of it. Generally speaking, the emphasis was on the design of the antenna. In fact, our Prime Minister has been emphasizing Make in India. In fact, I have actually added a line before that. Before Make in India to happen, it has to be designed in India. So until unless we do design in India, what are we going to make in India? So that was the whole crux of my course. That focus was on the design of the antenna. We'll also show you some practical antennas in our lab, and we'll show you how we do the measurement of some of the antenna parameter. So with that, best of luck. I hope you enjoyed the course on antennas, and hopefully you design your own antennas, fabricate your own antennas, and these antennas are required by all the, you can say, telecom industry. They are required by the space industry. These are required by the hobbyist also, and this is big way required by the defense industry. So all the best, and have a nice time in designing these antennas. Bye.